Tonight with us, we have Adrienne Raphel. She's the author of Thinking Inside the Box, Adventures with Crosswords, and the Puzzling People Who Can't Live Without Them, and What Was It For? Her essays, Poetry and Criticism, appear in The New Yorker, Poetry, The New Republic, The Atlantic, Paris Review Daily, Slate, Lena Turner Journal, Poets and Writers, The Iowa Review, and other publications. Born in New Jersey and raised in Vermont, Raphel holds a PhD in English from Harvard University, an MFA in poetry from the Iowa Writers Workshop, and an AB summa cum laude from Princeton University, where she's currently a lecturer at the Princeton Writing Program. So how this is going to work, Adrienne's going to start off the program with a little reading from the book, and then that'll be followed by a presentation and then a Q&A session at the end. So as questions come up and pop into your head, you should see an area to submit those. You can submit those at any time. I'll kind of collect them, and then at the end, I'll get to as many of those as time allows and as we can. So without further ado, welcome Adrienne.
Hi, everyone. Thanks so much for joining. And if you're joining this after the fact, once you have power back after the tropical storm wreaks some havoc, thanks for joining us at any time. So I'm and really, thank you so much, Andrew and West Hartford Library, for having me. It's such a pleasure to be here, but really, this is really great, and I'm excited to be able to join your virtual programming. So I'm going to start off with just a really brief reading, just to orient you to my book, Thinking Inside the Box, Adventures with Crosswords and the Puzzling People Who Can't Live Without Them. So I'll start with a brief reading, and then I'm going to give a little bit of a presentation to, just kind of walk through some of the history of the crossword puzzle, some fun stuff that happens with it. And then I wanted to end the presentation with what you can be doing right now with crossword puzzles, as there's some of the best things that we can use to have fun while socially distancing, but also being social. And then I'll be really excited to take some Q&A. So feel free to pop those in the chat. And Andrew, thanks for helping out with that as well. So this is just a couple of minutes from the introduction to the book, because I just want to get you oriented to the question that I maybe most frequently get, and feel free to keep asking it in the comments, but how and why does a person write a book on crossword puzzles? I started writing this book when I was 3. That's when I discovered what the alphabet could do. Using only a combination of these shapes on the page, I could beam down messages from my brain, which other people could put back together, making my message get wormed into their brains. Whenever I rode in the car, I'd play the alphabet game with my brother. We each had to find the letters of the alphabet in order, somewhere in the landscape zooming by, shouting out the letter and its sight upon sighting. Whoever got from A to Z fastest was the winner. Dairy Queen, Quiznos, and Jiffy Lube became shrines. When I was growing up, children's book author Roald Dahl's reader par excellence, Matilda, was my hero. I stared at the towel rack in the bathroom so hard my eyes blurred, willing myself to move something by shooting telekinetic beams from behind my eyeballs, the way Matilda used her mental power to pick up chalk. But I was even more excited about the other things that letters could do. How letters could arrange themselves into any words, and how certain combinations of letters suggested other ones, even when they seemed unrelated. Monday nights during high school, my family had crossword races. My father would make photocopies of the Monday New York Times puzzle, hand them out to us, and send us to separate corners of the house. At his shout, we'd flip them over and begin. I'd scramble to finish before hearing my brother crow, "Done!" I'd scrawl the final capital letters and rush into the living room, be coolly reading the rest of the day's art section, having breezed through the grid several minutes earlier. Dad would be pretending not to care anymore, a few scattered blank squares mocking him. As a senior in high school, I had to do a capstone research project that included a community service component. I did mine about crosswords. The centerpiece was a spiral-bound book of crosswords that I brought into a local eighth grade classroom, along with blank grids for the students to try their hand at puzzle making. My puzzles back then were objectively terrible. I didn't realize you should make the grid symmetrical or that all the letters should interlock with each other. So my puzzles looked like jack-o'-lanterns instead of neat quilts, clues slash snaggletooth across the page. Thinking inside the box investigates the crossword from all sides. I start with the crossword's origins, tracking how that first crossword in 1913 evolved from novelty to craze to routine. I construct a puzzle from soup to nuts, and I go behind the scenes with crossword editors to discover how a crossword goes from rough draft to publication. I investigate the myths around crosswords. Are crosswords frivolous toys that fritter your brain away? Will crosswords stave off dementia? I go to crossword tournaments to learn from the best solvers and constructors in the business. I even take a crossword-themed ocean crossing aboard the Queen Mary II. The more the crossword changes, the more it stays the same. The crossword is a reflection of everything happening around it, but it's also an anchor. In the wake of a particularly harrowing presidential election, an editor at the New Yorker said he found himself turning to the crossword puzzle as a life raft of stability in a world that had gone topsy-turvy. It's no accident that the crossword grew up during World War I and that the New York Times introduced its crossword during World War II. No matter how chaotic life is, solving a crossword puzzle gives you a sense of control. Seeing where the letters lead you sets the mind free. So, and I would add to that now that something that I couldn't have predicted when I wrote that introduction, but releasing this book during a pandemic has made me realize how great crosswords are as something to not just sort of do, but actually to provide routine and sustain your brain, give you a sense of anchoring control, and also give you a way to continue to both socialize with people, to, you know, center in yourself. Crossword is really something that has become sort of more important and vital than ever now. And so what I want to do for a couple of minutes is to that history of the crossword puzzle that I was starting to kind of walk you through at the end of the introduction. I want to spend a little bit of time thinking about how did the crossword begin? Where did it get its start? I'm going to also kind of give you a couple of cool stories. I talk about these in the book too, but I'm going to give you some visuals too of crosswords during wartime, and then also kind of jump to funky things with crosswords today. So I'm just going to share my screen and just we're going to hope that this works. Here we go. We good? Everybody can see this?
Yeah, that looks great. I see it here.
Awesome. So this is a brief and extremely selective history of the crossword. So the crossword has a birthday, December 21st, 1913. An editor named Arthur Wynn, who's worked for the New York World, which was a popular newspaper back around the turn of the century. So this editor introduces the crossword puzzle in the Christmas edition of the Fun supplement to the newspaper. Now, Arthur Wynn, so this is what the Fun supplement looked like. That's the cover to it, you can see. And then this is the first crossword puzzle. You'll notice it looks a little bit different than crossword puzzles look today. First of all, it's not a crossword puzzle, it's a word cross puzzle. Second of all, it's a diamond, not a square, right? It's sort of like a tilted crossword puzzle. It also doesn't have black squares in it, doesn't have blanks. It's got this like donut hole in the center of it instead, and it sort of surrounds it. But it's also, in many ways, extraordinarily similar to what we've got going on today. For a first attempt at a crossword puzzle, it actually sort of functionally hasn't changed that much. Some of the clues are a little weird. For instance, there's a clue somewhere. I'll just go back to fiber of the gomuti palm. I have no idea what that is. It's the word dough, D-O-H. Who knows? But Arthur Wynn had some kinks to work out. But the crossword puzzle actually, people really love this thing. It took. And lots of, cartoon, the crossword puzzle really, as it stuck around, something I really love is this cartoonist who, Ernie Bushmiller, who's best known for Nancy, actually got his start in the newspaper business drawing the crossword grids for the New York World. It's something that I didn't really think about as a thing, but somebody had to draw the grids actually by hand, and Ernie Bushmiller got really good at it. He also started making crossword themed cartoons, which he called Crossword Cal. I love this one. It really turns the world into a crossword puzzle. They're at the zoo. They're saying, an emu isn't labeled as an emu. It's labeled as sort of the crossword clue, three-letter dromaeus. Here's another Crossword Cal, where a cab driver says, well, here's a way to make a checkered cab. I'll put crossword puzzles on it. People will love that. The crossword puzzle became popular, from 1913 onward, but in 1924, the crossword puzzle really went viral, if we're allowed to still say that, with the publication of the crossword puzzle book, Simon and Schuster, the publishing company. This was actually the very first book that Simon and Schuster published. One of their aunts said to them, Aunt Wixie says, I would just love a collection of crossword puzzles for my niece. And they were like, well, okay. And so they said, but we better publish it under a different name. We don't want the August Simon and Schuster to be sullied with crossword puzzles. So they published it under the Plaza Publishing imprint. Actually, though, crossword puzzles became an enormous hit for them, a runaway success. The first crossword puzzle book sold 123,000 copies in its first year. Second edition sold 110,000 more copies by Christmas of 1924. The third series had already sold 40,000 copies. It's just enormously successful for them. So crosswords really took off. Crosswords also just became a huge fad in the 20s. This is one of my favorite things. This is a sketch of a lady posing in her beautiful crossword hat with her crossword sort of cape going on, a bracelet. This, I'm gonna see if this works. Here's a little clip of a song from the 1920s with the crossword craze going on. It's called Crossword Mama, You Puzzle Me, But Papa's Gonna Figure You Out. This is the chorus.
Look, that might be through your headphones.
Oh, okay, yeah, here we go.
From the beginning.
Mama, mama, said Mr. Rasmus. Mama, mama, the way you talk these days, I have to get your ways. You're like the crossword craze. Crossword, mama, you puzzle me. The papa's gonna figure you out. You call me honey, and that means me. Looks like I'll be stung, no doubt.
Anyway, could you hear that at all?
Yeah, I was dancing.
All right, awesome. Yeah, you get the idea. That's what people were grooving to in the 20s. There was a Broadway musical called Puzzles of 1925, which featured a crossword sanatorium. This I totally love. This is a clip from a short film by Walt Disney in this sort of series of Alice comedies that he did. And one comedy was called Alice Solves the Puzzle. So it starts off.
Alice.
that's the setup for Alice Solves the Puzzle. Her weird cat friend gets her to go off swimming, but the whole short movie, she's actually just thinking about the crossword puzzle the whole time. She's, you know, and anybody who solves a crossword puzzle knows that feeling. You cannot get the word, you can't get it. You go and do something else, you sort of let it marinate in the back of your brain, and then finally... Such as it is. So there's some like funky tidbits of from the 1920s crossword craze. Fast forward to the 1940s, when crosswords actually played a big role in World War II, on both sides of the pond. So in England, crossword puzzles catch on quickly as well, but in England they start something called cryptic crosswords, which look a little bit different than American crosswords. I can talk about that a bit more later on in the Q&A if you want me to. But if you're interested in the difference between American and British crosswords. But so in England, crossword puzzles actually become part of the war effort. This is a picture of Bletchley Park, which is where the Enigma codebreakers were during World War II. And they actually recruited Enigma codebreakers by putting a contest puzzle in the newspaper. They said, if you can solve this puzzle, they said, oh, it's a contest for the puzzle. We're just looking for the best solvers. And then snap, it actually turned out that the best solvers, a few days later, the government officials came to their door and said, oh, you know, that wasn't just a crossword puzzle thing. That was a recruitment thing. And now we would like you to help break codes for World War II. So you're a good crossword puzzle solver. That means you must be clever. You must be good at puzzles. We need you to help in the war. Something kind of sinister happens though later on in the war. So the Daily Telegraph crossword starts having these kind of weird answers. In the months before D-Day, Gold, Sword, and Juno come up as answers. And it turns out these are code names for D-Day beaches. Then really close to D-Day, Utah, Mulberry, Neptune, Overlord, these code names for D-Day operations start showing up as crossword puzzle answers. And, you know, Gold and Sword, okay, sure, they're common words, but Utah, Mulberry, Neptune, Overlord, like those aren't super common words. They're not clued as D-Day answers, but you know, there's a lot of these code words sneaking in. What is going on? And you can see these are all like sort of invasion beaches and they all end up in the crossword puzzle. Turns out that they, not only that, they traced all the crossword puzzles back to one single constructor, this guy named Leonard Daw, who's the headmaster at the Strand School in London. So they traced them all back to this one guy. So, you know, intelligence officers come knocking at his door one day, not to invite him to break the Enigma code, but to say, hey, you are putting all of these code names into the puzzle. What is going on? Leonard Daw says, I have no idea what's going on and what are you talking about? Turns out that the Strand School located here was next door to an army base. Leonard Daw, the headmaster, needed help filling in his puzzle, so he lets his students come in and fill in words in the puzzle sometimes. The students had picked up words from the army base, those words that the soldiers were tossing around, which were Utah, Mulberry, Overlord, Neptune, these code words. The students didn't know what they were. They're just like, oh, cool words. They bring them back into the crossword. It's this whole thing where they thought that this guy was a traitor. It turns out that the students were just overhearing cool words. But the crossword are basically this close of accused of being a traitor to the war effort. So crosswords, fine code breakers, but crosswords also might be sneakily kind of a double agent. So, you know, you think you're playing an innocent game, not as innocent as you might think. Also during World War II, the New York Times finally got into the crossword game. The New York Times, as you may know, it's the most popular crossword in America, certainly right now. A lot of people sort of equate the New York Times crossword with the crossword. It's really a gold standard. The New York Times at first really poo-pooed the crossword. They were like, it's a primitive sort of mental exercise. The claimed merit, you know, as little basis of fact, nothing except words' existence is discovered in the crossword. We hate the crossword. But during World War II, just 11 days after Pearl Harbor Day, an editor writes to the publisher and says, you know what? The New York Times is going to get super, super grim during the war. We need something to give to the people that is not terrible, terrible headlines. Please let us have a crossword. Turns out the publisher of the paper was secretly a huge fan of the crossword. He'd been buying a rival paper on the side and to just get the crossword. So he says, great, cool. I'll have one in the puzzle. I'll have a crossword in the newspaper. So on both sides of the pond, the point is that during the war, the crossword really becomes this major force. I want to jump ahead a little bit into the present to talk about like some fun ways the crossword craze has continued. More crossword fashion. This one here with the stockings, that's kind of from the 1920s. But this here in the center, this model is, she's showing off a collection from just a couple years ago by fashion designer Lisa Perry, who decided, she's a New York-based fashion designer, and she decided to make a whole collection kind of revolving around black and white squares because they're so iconic. Barbie got into the crossword puzzle, apparently. This I totally love. This is an image from Will Shortz's private collection. So Will Shortz, the editor of the New York Times crossword, NPR's puzzle master, another, he runs the big crossword tournament every year, the American Crossword Puzzle Tournament in Stamford, Connecticut. Usually. So this is from his private collection. This is a crossword pinball machine. He's got it in his basement, I believe. So another thing that you can do during the pandemic, which people on Twitter have taken to, is you go hunting for crosswords. Crosswords are sort of all over the place, right? You can find a crossword image in lots of different places, but a lot of the kind of iconic crossword images are not actually crosswords. For instance, this great Lisa Perry fabric, all these great kind of pattern crossword fabrics, if you tried to do them as crosswords, sad to say you wouldn't get very far. So there was a Peanuts comic strip about the crossword in which, Woodstock helps out Snoopy to fill in a crossword with his own little dash language. Unfortunately, it's not actually a crossword puzzle. Crosswords kind of, American crosswords demand that the squares, you could never ever have just one square floating without anything checked or without it kind of lining up like that. So it's a cute crossword, it's a cute comic, but the puzzle wouldn't really work, unfortunately. This still is from Parks and Rec. So there's a crossword puzzle in the Pawnee Journal, which is just kind of a really terrible crossword puzzle in terms of an actual puzzle to solve. If you look close, it's just got that like letter, the clues just sort of start randomly in the middle of a sea of squares. Would never fly in in a more rigorous crossword setting. But, you know, maybe this is actually a little joke with the Parks and Rec writer saying the Pawnee Journal is just so not there that their crossword puzzle is really not quite up to snuff. So this is a crossword that the Riddler asked Batman to solve. Unfortunately, it is not a great crossword puzzle. It looks pretty unfilled. There's not much symmetry going on. Again, you've got these squares that aren't checked by other squares. So a thing you can do in the pandemic, if you're sick of actually solving crosswords, or if you want to kind of boost up your repertoire, you can like kind of go in and find images of crosswords and say, is that a crossword? Is it not? Etsy sells a lot of crossword face masks, crossword printed face masks. Some of them don't quite work as crossword puzzles. But if you're also excited about new things you can do with the crossword puzzle, I highly recommend trying to make your own crossword puzzle. There's some software you can download and to make it a lot easier. You can join a crossword class. A lot of these have been popping up online, which is really great. JASA in New York City, their class has just gone online. So Jewish Association Serving Aging. And it's every Sunday at 2, I think, or you know, several Sundays a month. I can also pop these in the chat or send them to you, Andrew, at some point to distribute if you guys are interested. Constructors like Ross Trudeau run frequent seminars. He's got one coming up this weekend. So you can, you know, search around a little and try your hand at crossword making. You can also try online tournaments. You know, the crossword tournament scene is a really fun, lively, robust scene. And it's moved online in a really successful way. So one coming up on August 15 is a tournament called Lollapuzzoola, normally in New York, but it's now going online. And I'm sure these will continue to happen. And they're really, really fun. You just do a bunch of crosswords, but you do them in camaraderie with lots of other people doing them. If you're interested in trying your hand at that. You can also check out crossword titles from the library. For example, there's lots of fun mystery books that feature crosswords. I'm not sure if you know you guys have these or you could borrow, direct them or something like that, but there's some fun crossword themed mystery books that or other titles that use crosswords in them. And then I can't help it, you can also check out my book if you're interested in reading about puzzles. So there's crosswords are just here for you at all times. There's plenty to do with them. So with that, I think I'll just open it up to, I'll stop sharing my screen for now and open it up for questions.
Okay, so again, you can submit in the Q&A feature and I'll get them and try to read them as they come in. Looking at your presentation, I couldn't help think just how, you know, ubiquitous it seems they were when they first came out, crosswords. It kind of reminded me of when Pokemon Go came out. It's probably, I don't know, 5-6 years ago at this point, but just like how popular it became, and it seemed like that scene in the zoo when people just kind of, you know, took over everything and everybody was doing it. So I imagine that was life in the 1913. So I got to admit, I'm not a crossword enthusiast. However, I picked up your book a few weeks ago and I dove right in, and now I'm kind of addicted to the New York Times crossword puzzle app. So I've been going back and just doing, I started with the minis, which are the shorter crosswords, and then kind of expanded from there. So one thing I kind of picked up on is that some of them have like reappearing words. Specifically, I think you bring up in the book Oreo, the brand of cookie or type of cookie or whatever, however you want to consider it. But that seems like one of those like Scrabble type words that are just like worth a ton of points or very valuable. So I'm curious, does any thought go into the word frequency of crosswords? Is it measured somehow? Do people take it into account when they're making a puzzle?
That's a great question. And it's something that people take into account really seriously when they're creating a puzzle. And so I want to talk about a couple of different things with that briefly. So Oreo, which you mentioned, Andrew, I kind of use it as a touchstone word in the book for thinking about also different cultures that come into the crossword and different, where do your words come from and like what types of words are allowed to appear in a crossword puzzle? What are constructors using? And so Oreo becomes a real like touchstone for a switch that happened in the crossword puzzle from the 60s, 70s, 80s when the New York Times crossword and others didn't allow brand names to be in the puzzle, but yet Oreo is such a good word. Apparently it's some obscurely like a mountain combining form. It's a prefix that it exists as a word in the dictionary. So that's how constructors used to have to clue Oreo. Basically in 1993, when Will Shortz took over as the puzzle editor at the Times, he said, this is absolutely ridiculous. Everybody knows that an Oreo is a cookie. Come on, people. It's like not that hard. And so, but what that did was that opened up actually a whole world of, okay, we can have more pop culture references in the crossword. We can have brand names. We don't have to just rely on knowledge that is restricted to, you know, maybe like some kind of really specialized Ivy League education. You know, we can actually bring in knowledge from lots of other places. That it doesn't mean that you're dumbing down the crossword. On the contrary, I think that, you know, the more words the crossword can absorb, the better it's going to become, you know. And so I think it's really just crossword constructors today are having so much more fun with the fact that you can clue RAE as Issa Rae, the, you know, star of HBO's Insecure and other and lots of other things, not just kind of have to rely on a sort of set of different, a set of, you know, cultural touchstones only from one particular bandwidth of culture. Now it's just become a much more diverse and inclusive place. I could go on, but that's probably enough for now.
Yeah, thanks. When you were speaking about that too, I was thinking about just the, not only accessibility in terms of like the words and clues that people would know, but also just like sometimes how immediate they are. And one puzzle that I did recently asked about who threw out the first pitch at the Nationals game in 2020, and it was Fauci, I think, that did it. So I'm just curious about, you know, shelf life of a crossword, you know, what's the amount of time there that they look at as far as being too immediate or timeless?
It's a great question. The New York Times, because everybody can submit and everybody who submits from the most veteran constructors to total newbies submits the same way. Now you can email them in. You had to originally sort of mail them all in. But anyway, so everybody submits the same way. So that means, and just because there's only a few editors, there's a pretty big backlog in the New York Times. And, you know, so it can take a while for your puzzle to get in there. On the other hand, you know, they can be more nimble and respond to things more. So you can have a, you know, a puzzle that I know a constructor who had a puzzle accepted in March and it didn't run until probably like October or maybe like October of the following year or something. Crosswords can be beautifully evergreen, but you're right, they can also be incredibly timely. One way the Times gets around it is you mentioned the minis. So Joel Faliano creates a mini crossword every day. Those are super timely. If you notice that those are often responding to the week's news, you know, not the months that you, but so that's a way that the New York Times crossword can both be a place that reflects what's going on immediately and a place that says, okay, we're going to actually be a more sort of evergreen, not news-oriented place. Other publications that don't have the sense of like, you know, lots and lots of submissions, like the New Yorker rotates around a couple constructors or a handful of constructors. So they have a little bit more power to be a little bit like more, you know, on more timely, more current. Constructors who kind of do their own puzzle every week can also be more current. So it depends on what you're after as a puzzle.
Nice, we got a few more questions coming in. People were curious about the difference between the British crosswords and American crosswords that you referenced earlier.
Yeah, totally. So when crosswords hopped the pond in the 1920s, in Britain, what became really popular as a style were cryptic crosswords. So cryptic crosswords are basically, each clue has two parts to it. It's got the straight up definition and it's got a little wordplay element too. So part of the clue, and there's always a part of the clue that tells you what it wants you to do. So if it says something like scrambled in it, you know, it wants you to anagram the word around. So a really complex example, but one that really illustrates what's going on is the clue, pretty girl in crimson rose, pretty girl in crimson rose. And the answer, I'm going to spoil it, is rebelled. Okay, so rebelled, R-E-B-E-L-L-E-D. A pretty girl is a bell, so that's a bell. In crimson, R-E, D. So a bell in crimson, red. And then rose, so like rose as in rebelled, as in uprising. So pretty girl in crimson rose. So is rebelled. That's the often the kind of cluing that's going on in a cryptic. It's got all these layers to it. It's got intense wordplay, and also you kind of figure it out from the definition. Cryptic crosswords look a little bit different from American ones. American ones, as I was mentioning, all the letters have to be checked. So all of them have to have all the across and down have to have a corresponding one to it, right? So cryptics, you don't have to do that. You can have them look, they look more like sort of lines. They don't look as much like that symmetrical interlocked grid.
Yeah, I don't think I would have gotten that.
this Pretty Girl in Crimson Rose is actually the title of a pretty excellent memoir about a South African man who gets really into British crossword puzzles, and like a lot of the introduction is explaining how that clue works, so I will give that credit.
Also related to how challenging crossword puzzles are, someone in the chat asked about coming across a crossword 30 years old or so from the New York Times crossword puzzle book. They found it difficult and they couldn't get started. So they're wondering, are they generally more or less challenging these days?
Yeah, that's a great question. And so it's funny because sometimes there's like some theories that say that crosswords get easier because the words sort of are a little bit more in the language, like they sort of are just like the words themselves are around more, like the older the crossword is. But I think a crossword from the New York Times in particular from 30, 40 years ago won't feel the same as a New York Times crossword today, because as I was mentioning, the editor, it was different. That was probably edited by someone named Eugene Maleska, who was really a fan of like kind of the super obscure. He wanted an Oreo to be a mountain prefix, not a cream filled cookie. So the crosswords are pulling from they're pulling from super obscure areas of the dictionary, basically. And if you do a bunch of Maleska crosswords, he also likes to have crossword ease. So the kinds of words that only appear in crossword, like A-E-R-I-E is a super crossword ease word, like an eagle's nest, right? So an airy, like you kind of don't see that word all the time in your day to day. In an Eugene Maleska puzzle from the 80s, you'll see it all the time. You know, so basically they just do feel different because that crossword editor actually preferred a particular kind of cluing and a particular kind of words. So it's not surprising that the crossword will, it looks the same on the page, but once you get into it, you realize, oh, I'm not doing the same kind of puzzle.
Yeah, and kind of getting into the behind the scenes of crosswords, someone asks, they started reading a New York Times article that goes along with the daily crossword. It sounds like the New York Times has a big team of people working with Will Shorts in the puzzle department. Any idea how big it is or what's going on there?
Yeah, so it's really fascinating. So Will Shorts works from, you know, he works sort of in his home in Pleasantville, New York, and he works with a few editors. So Joel Faliano and Sam Azartskine, I think one or two other people are actually editing the puzzle with Will Shorts. So, it's a pretty small group of editors. It's three or four editors to the puzzle. The big team comes in two places. There's like a medium-sized team that's actually at the New York Times that's working on the digital games. So like the whole kind of digital crew of the New York Times. So the ones putting up not only the crossword, but the mini, but and the spelling bee and the tiles and the Ken and the Sudoku and all the other games they have up there. There's a lot of people who have to do that. So the digital games team is big. What's huge and, you know, potentially infinite is the amount of freelance constructors who are sending their puzzles into the New York Times. So there's, your puzzle every day is constructed by a freelance constructor. So they're not employees of the Times, but they're sending them in. So there's kind of a smaller pool of editors, medium kind of games, digital people, and then like lots and lots of constructors sending other puzzles in to be edited.
Do they get any sort of compensation if they're crossword selected?
Yeah, they do. And that's actually, they're getting more compensation now than they used to just a few years ago. It's on the Times website how much it is. I think you get, now I think it's 500 for a daily and 1,000 or 1,100 for a Sunday crossword because they're bigger. And if you've been, if you're a regular, like if you've published 10 or more puzzles, that rate actually jumps. It's like 750 for a daily and 2,000 for a Sunday. So to encourage kind of regular submissions. So that, and that's, and that number has definitely gone up pretty a lot in the past couple of years.
Yeah, because I would think for crossword enthusiasts, at least initially, there's probably the thrill of having it published and probably the love of crosswords so much where, you know, you would do it probably for very little. So I'm surprised to hear those figures.
Yeah, no, it's fascinating. I mean, when I tried to construct a crossword in the book and my first effort took me, I thought it would be like an afternoon. It took me like 3 weeks and it did not get in the paper. It was not a great puzzle, but I was kind of calculating it out. How much an hour I would make. I was probably losing money as I was constructing this puzzle. But yeah, I think, you know, for such a long time, it was really like people constructed for the love of constructing, but that also restricts who gets to construct a puzzle, because then it only gets to be people who have a lot of leisure time on their hands. And so then, and it's a lot of labor. It's really, these things are really fascinating but tricky to make. So you should be compensated for your time.
Yeah, definitely. Mm-hmm. If only we can get compensated for completing them too, but maybe one day. All right, a few more questions came in. Judith is interested in what the cognitive benefits are to crossword puzzles, especially as we age.
Yeah, there's been lots of fascinating studies about this. To give away the ending, basically, there's been lots of studies on either side that say crosswords can totally help your brain and they can stave off dementia, and then studies that say, well, I'm not really so sure. Actually, like, we can't actually prove that in the study because maybe the people who are doing crosswords are already sort of genetically predisposed not to get, or maybe they're doing other things that keep their brain healthy. There really have been kind of studies that prove yes, prove no. I would say the jury's out, but they can't harm you. They can't be bad for you. One thing I did want to mention briefly, the Alzheimer's Association has done some really like extraordinary, really cool ads using the crossword puzzle where they do an ad where the crossword, it looks like a normal crossword puzzle, but it's all tailored to a specific person, like Marie's favorite brand of cookies, or where did Marie go to the pub last night? And the ad at the bottom says, can't solve this puzzle, neither can Marie. So it's like so that's an interesting ad, is like using the crossword as a way, and not being able to solve it as a way to think about dementia in a different way. So I think it's a really cool, interesting idea for a way of understanding Alzheimer's. So that's a sort of a flip side, but I think, but the in terms of studies about dementia, really it's gone both ways and crosswords can't harm you.
Yeah, I would think, yeah, that would be your catch-all response. It's like, yeah, what probably doesn't harm you if you enjoy them. All right, other questions about crossword protocols or rules that seem to be much more flexible than Scrabble rules. Can you speak to any way that crossword construction relates or doesn't relate to Scrabble?
Oh, that's fascinating. I know a lot less about Scrabble than I do about crosswords. What I will say about crossword rules that I think are so cool and why construction is both so tricky, but also sort of artistically rewarding is that there are rules that crossword constructors follow. So in American style crossword, there are certain parameters, like crosswords have got to be symmetrical, and you want to kind of limit the like really bad crosswordies, these abbreviations, crosswords. There's lots of other things in there too, but you have constructors who are really always pushing the boundaries of what a crossword can do. They're playing with how many 15 letter words can I get to stack on top of each other and still make all words going down, right? So like, you know, they're playing with, oh, maybe if I make a puzzle constructor Liz Gorski a few years ago made a puzzle that was shaped like a spiral and it had all of these paintings in it and these painters and all these like sculptors and artists in it, and turns out that the whole theme of the puzzle was about the Guggenheim Museum because she was following that famous spiral of the Guggenheim. So she's pushing the limits and saying, what can a crossword do visually? So the crossword construction, I think, is so great because crossworders are always pushing at, what can my crossword look like? What can the grid do? What can the clues do? What kind of new wordplay and new like funny thing can I put into the clues? And where can I draw from in terms of what references can I have as my answers to it too? So Scrabble, I think, is a little bit more set because you've sort of, you're working with letters to be sure. You're in both and you're working with moving around letters, but Scrabble's a little bit more constrained. I think crossword constructors actually have a bit more flexibility and more freedom in the ways that they can think about how the game works.
All right, next question was about the bios of the greats. Forgive me if I'm saying this wrong, like Merle Regal were the ones at the Boston Globe?
So Merle Regal, he was so great. What was the question? Was the bio of them?
Yeah, so I think he's interested in just wondering if you've maybe in the book done a bio of these greats. I think you mentioned, was it something like there's only been like 4 or 5 editors throughout the beginning in the New York Times as crossword editors? So yeah, I guess just kind of maybe the history of the people involved and how much you bio them in the book.
Oh, sure. Yeah. So thanks for clarifying. So there are so many fantastic constructors and editors who have, you know, been with us in the century plus of crosswording. You know, Merle Regal, great, fabulous constructor, really funny constructor, had all these like pun-filled crosswords, really sort of like pushed the like jokey crossword in this great way. There's so many. If you can go on the site xwordinfo.com, which is a repository of all New York Times crosswords. They have little bios of all the constructors on there. So that website sort of has more room than I do in the book to profile them all. I ended up profiling, as Andrew mentioned, the New York Times editors, because there's been so few. There's Margaret Farrer, who's the first editor of the New York Times crossword, and actually sort of the first editor of the New York World crossword after Arthur Wynn. So she's sort of the grand dame of crosswords. And then I walked through a few others. Eugene Maleska, I mentioned, Will Shortz, Will Wang. So Margaret Farrer, Will Wang, Eugene Maleska, Will Shortz, that's sort of the four editors of the New York Times crossword since 1942. So I profile them in the book and a couple others. Ruth von Fool, who was this like famous solver in the 1920s, who then became a Joyce scholar. In the chapter I have on the crossword tournament, I talk about several really great crossword solvers today, like Dan Fair and Eric Agar and stuff like that.
Yeah, I'm trying to think about what sort of backgrounds these figures would have. I mean, obviously probably very well read, but is there any sort of common biographical background between them, whether it be like an area of study or just upbringing that, you know, maybe predisposes them to being good at this?
What's fascinating to me is that several of the people who are really great solvers and constructors today come from a math music background, which makes sense because crosswords are a real right brain, left brain thing. They really require you to be great at spotting patterns, but also they require you to have this kind of verbal acuity too. So there's a lot of math and music and software, but then also with this verbal stuff going on. And so, yeah, more crossworders than I would have suspected going into this research come from a math music kind of background. You know, Will Schwartz, his background is really great. He grew up on a horse farm in Indiana. He he made up a field of study for himself at Indiana University called enigmatology. So the study of puzzles, basically. And he went to law school, and I don't know if he ever practiced law, but he basically, after law school, said, okay, I want to create and solve crossword puzzles. So yeah, I think that crossword people are everywhere. They come from everywhere. There's no one common background, which I find glorious. What I find great though is that crossword people are, you know, there's a mathy side, but they're also just coming from everywhere. So I think that's so cool.
Yeah, and speaking of coming from everywhere, that leads into the next question pretty well. Marianne's asking about what other countries have crossword puzzles in their cultures in addition to the US and Britain?
Oh yeah, that's great. I talk about this some in the book too. There's there's crosswords in other languages, right? It's harder to get crosswords in languages like Chinese and Japanese that are not alphabetic, that are more pictogram symbol based. That's a little bit harder just mechanically to create a crossword, but there's a pretty robust French tradition of crosswords. French crosswords are really hard. people who are really good at English language crosswords and are fluent in French have told me that French crosswords are just like, if you think British cryptics are hard, French crosswords somehow also add other layers of wordplay into them. There's a really, like, French crosswords just happen to be really hard. Italian, there's a lot of, there's interesting Italian tradition. Crosswords are, the crosswords are very, very popular in India as well. And there's a lot of crosswords in Canada. There's a lot of crosswords in Germany. They're all over the place. They're easier in alphabetic languages, but there are sort of analogs in kind of any language you can find. You'll find a crossword.
Cool. That would be good to kind of, you know, if they had some sort of equivalent to like the mini, if you were learning a language, that might be maybe frustrating, but maybe also helpful initially to kind of learn the language in a fun way.
Yeah, there's lots of different, if you go on to kind of education and, you know, teacher websites, they'll often use crosswords as vocab quizzes in foreign languages or actually like in bio class or something to sort of learn the language of biology. You can get a crossword with that. So, but I think you're totally right. It's a great way to learn the language.
All right, so I guess we'll end things with the final question, just about maybe recommendations you have. I'll try to maybe, like I said, we'll recording this webinar, so we hope to post it, and when we do, we can put those links from your presentation up, which had the links to creating your own crossword puzzle. But in general, any other recommendations around the topic, whether it be reading or apps or anything this crowd might enjoy?
Yeah, absolutely. The New York Times crossword app I would recommend downloading. It's or playing on your iPad or whatever desktop you're using. It's really great, and they have a lot. They have minis, so they have everything from minis to, you know, the archives of hard Friday and Saturday puzzles. The New York Times goes Monday through Saturday, you know, easiest to hardest. So I think that's really a great way to get a lot of variety of puzzles. Other websites that have some great puzzles, The New Yorker has a really strong crossword puzzle right now. And that has different levels now too. The Atlantic has a really nice crossword puzzle. I would also like completely recommend checking out collections of crosswords. Will Shortz, edited by Will, you know, like edited by Will Shortz, there's all these collections that he's done, sort of omnibus puzzles. So if you're interested in a bunch of easy puzzles or a bunch of hard puzzles or like lots of different kinds of puzzles, I would recommend those. I would also, let's see, So really I would just say though, like, you know, get your hands on a collection and go from there.
Yeah, as I mentioned before, I didn't do crosswords a whole lot till recently, but I found the app, the New York Times one, was pretty intuitive. I thought that it would be a little bit clunky in terms of filling stuff in and then trying to pivot the across versus the down, or even going back and deleting things, but it's a pretty well-made app. So even on my phone, I found it pleasurable.
Yeah, no, it's I think it's very well-made. And also if you are interested in British style crosswords, cryptic crosswords, The Guardian has a fabulous crossword blog. It's written by someone named Alan Connor, who's also written a very nice crossword history. And that blog has lots of nice tips about where do I start with a cryptic? What is this thing? What does this mean? So that's a place I would point you to if you want to branch, you know, think outside the box a little bit and branch into cryptics.
Nice. I like the product placement there at the end. Speaking of the book, we do have copies. I'm returning this one tomorrow to Noah Webster Library, so that should be available. And then I think there's copies at each of the branches. So if you wanted to get a copy, we're doing curbside service at all three. I also encourage you to go out and purchase the book as well. Any bookstores that you'd like to plug or general spots to find information about your book?
Totally. I would always recommend go to your local indie bookstore, and any place online. Bookshop.org is doing some great work connecting with independent bookstores. You can go to my website, which is adrienneraphel.com, and I have a lot of links on there. You can go to Penguin Random House website for the book. Anywhere that you feel like supporting and ordering, and please use the library, of course. So those are some pretty easy ways to get links.
All right, great. So thanks a lot, Adrienne. Appreciate you taking the time to meet with us all. I know you're in Vermont. Was the storm bad up there?
We got some rain, but I know that other places were hit harder, so I really, you know, hope that you guys get all your power back and everything cleared out.
Yeah, thanks a lot. So, and thanks to all of you for coming out. We'll try to post on social media in the next few days when the video is available to watch again. But again, thank you, Adrienne.
Thank you so much. Take care.
All right, bye-bye.